Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Clairvoyant of the Small, The Life of Robert Walser, by Susan Bernofsky. Narrated by Natasha Soudek. Introduction. Searching for Robert Walser. Not so long ago, Robert Walser was the greatest modernist author you'd never heard of. Although much admired as a young writer in his native Switzerland and beyond, including by his contemporaries Franz Kafka, Robert Musil, Hermann Hesse, and Thomas Mann, he was almost forgotten in later life, and his obscurity outlived him. Only after the centenary of his birth was his work rediscovered and enthusiastically embraced by new generations of readers and scholars. A writer's writer celebrated mainly for his brilliant short prose, Walser is now recognized as one of the most singular and original voices of the early 20th century. He is also revered as a literary antihero who lived and wrote on the margins of society, a romantic outsider. The bits of Walser's life story best known today are that he trained as a bank clerk and butler when young, and later spent decades as an inpatient in a psychiatric clinic, dying while out for a solitary walk in the snow. Readers in the English-speaking world might know his novel about butler school, Jakob von Gunten, on which the film Institute Benjamenta by the Brothers Quay is based, or have picked up a copy of Selected Stories of Robert Walser from 1982 with the foreword by Susan Sontag. Those who encountered Walser more recently may have heard first of the miniature manuscripts, microscripts, he produced during the latter part of his career, though not only while institutionalized, as is widely and erroneously believed. Undoubtedly important elements of his story, these together create a somewhat misleading picture of the person and author, Robert Walser. In this book, I aim to fill in the gaps and present a portrait of the artist as a literary professional, a master craftsman who encountered many obstacles on his path, but remained unwaveringly devoted to his art. For most of his career, Walser eked out a modest living by his pen, above all as an author of the short newspaper texts known as feuilletons, brief sketches or anecdotes drawn from ordinary life, not unlike the New Yorker's talk of the town section, a genre he transformed into a vehicle for spectacular feats of narration. The misperception of Walser as a minor writer was to some extent a result of his cultivating this form and devoting his work to small subjects and modest motifs. Spinning tales around insignificance, he preached a gospel of appreciation for the overlooked marvels that surround us, prompting W.G. Sebald to dub him a clairvoyant of the small. "We don't need to see anything out of the ordinary," one Walser narrated proclaims. "We already see so much." For glorifying the modest and inconspicuous, Walser is cherished by many for whom this stance represents a rejection of, and resistance to, the pernicious commodification of contemporary life. Forced to leave school at age 14 out of economic necessity, Walser apprenticed as a bank clerk in his native Biel, while harboring dreams of becoming an actor. After moving to Zurich to work in the bookkeeping division of an insurance firm, he published his first poems and then quit his job to devote himself to writing. Soon after his first book, Fritz Kocha's Essays, appeared, he moved to Berlin to join his older brother Karl, an artist and stage set designer. The two became notorious for their antics and boisterous conduct, a pair of enfants terribles, living large among the creative spirits of pre-lapsarian Berlin, a hotbed of literacy and cultural activity. Thanks to his brother, Walser was welcomed into lofty artistic circles. but he felt ill at ease in high society, which he rebelled against by enrolling in Butler School, scandalizing his artistic peers. Even after beginning to perform as a writer by producing novels, three in rapid succession that were well received by critics, including Musil, his books failed to reach a wider audience. They were too quirky, too seemingly modest, too Swiss. And while his short prose was admired by fellow writers, Kafka loved reading Walser aloud, the young dreamer was soon a has-been with writer's block. He retreated back to Switzerland in defeat. Robert Walser's true career begins here. As his dream of literary stardom fizzled, he began to experiment with short prose forms that, over the next two decades, developed into the high modernist masterpieces that became his signature achievement. Taking the feuilleton-style essay as his starting point, he layered on strata of descriptive flourish and metaphor until he'd constructed elaborate edifices around the simplest topics interwoven with fictional elements, such that it was impossible to tell where essay ended and story began. Walser's protagonists include children, social outcasts, artists, the impoverished, the marginalized, and the forgotten. All these figures have a penchant for speaking in remarkably erudite, well-crafted, and above all, lengthy sentences whose complexity and intelligence belie the ostensible insignificance of those who utter them. An astute observer of power differentials, he writes of servants whose employers cower inwardly before them because they understand that their dominance is precarious and must be either voluntarily acknowledged or physically enforced. Thus, the powerful find themselves desiring and depending on their subordinates' goodwill. But if nurturing a desire of any sort means surrendering power, Walser describes such renunciation as a joyful, empowering act. Irony permeates Walser's universe. Not, however, the sardonic and occasionally sarcastic sort famously associated, for example, with Thomas Mann. Walserian irony is a different Weltanschauung altogether. Juxtaposing modesty with stunning verbal opulence, Walser's words ascend from the terrain they purport to map, taking flight and sketching such mesmerizing arabesques that a sentence's ostensible meaning becomes the least important thing about it. Walser's prose pieces spiral around their topics, amassing observations, thoughts, and insights until all human history appears contained in the simple act of, say, looking at a picture. The thick texture of his prose foregrounds the writing itself, his syntactical and semantic complexity reflecting the jangling, anxiety-ridden, euphoric spirit of the modern age. His later narratives are characterized by abrupt changes of topic and direction. A new phrase might be prompted by a rhyme that provokes an association or a metaphor that sparks its own sub-narrative. His winding sentences parody bureaucratic German by filling in structures with disorienting phrases. The relativizing adverbs he favors, approximately, perhaps, probably, so to speak, constrict their object until the firm ground of factual assertion disappears entirely. Reading Walser's late stories is like watching a murmuration of starlings in swirling flight. Even those who know his work well can rarely predict where his mind will go next. Echoes of his early writings can be heard in Kafka, and the influence of his later work stands out in Friedrich Dürrenmatt, Peter Handke, and Thomas Bernhardt, along with many other writers who have found inspiration in his pages. Seen from the 21st century, with our lives increasingly defined by an infinitely networked and often militarized global culture, even for those of us who, unlike Walser, never performed wartime service, it is easy to identify with his ambivalent response to the jarring new technologies of his age. Of all the writers who set out to unmask the idle progress, none understood more acutely what havoc, velocity, and mechanization were wreaking on the human spirit. While the inspirations of city life and its tempo are clearly visible in much of his work, he often cuts against the technological grain by nostalgically, and only half ironically, invoking of Romanticism's medieval past. The stock figures of the pageboy and itinerant journeyman poet appear frequently in his early writings. The trope of the itinerant journeyman is one Walser came to regret, as it was directly overused in assessments of his work. But this figure accords well with his preferred method of reclaiming the landscapes in and around the Swiss and German cities where he lived, striding through them on foot. A prodigious walker who preferred his own 2 feet to any other form of transportation, he thought nothing of walking all night, traversing, say, the 18 miles from Bern to Thun, and then climbing a mountain in the morning. Many of these walks became the basis for some of his best-known stories, such as his novella The Walk, set in Biel. Unlike a flaneur, moving through a city at a leisurely pace, obsessively noting and recording experiences in granular detail, Walser was a speedy walker devoted to swift apperception and glimpses following one another quickly. Uncompromisingly averse to being fenced in or unencumbered in any way, Walser moved restlessly from city to city, Stuttgart, Munich, Zurich, Berlin, Biel, Bern, and especially within these cities, inhabiting an endless succession of furnished rooms, usually rented from older women. He relocated as many as 13 times per year, his few possessions stashed in a suitcase, supporting himself on the modest fees he received for his books and magazine and newspaper publications. He spent most of his life in straitened circumstances, which he preferred to surrendering the freedom to live and work as he chose. By the mid-1920s, Walser was living an economically precarious existence in Bern, the Swiss capital, with even fewer publishers, including the newspapers he depended on for income, interested in his work, the more radical it became. He was socially isolated, drinking heavily, and increasingly unconventional in his behavior and affect as mental illness became a complicating factor in his life. In 1929, at age 50, and at the height of his creative powers, he entered Waldau Asylum outside Bern. He would spend his remaining 28 years in institutional confinement. During his intake interview, he reported experiencing auditory hallucinations, insomnia, depression, and an inability to concentrate, symptoms recorded in his medical record along with a diagnosis of schizophrenia, now considered questionable. Afraid to be alone at night, Walser turned down the offer of a private room, preferring to sleep in a communal dormitory. It remains uncertain what his condition was, precisely, and whether it warranted long-term hospitalization. Although he committed himself voluntarily, it was not with the expectation of making the clinic his permanent home. Still, the asylum was, among other things, a refuge. He had been desperate for relief from a paralyzing isolation. As one of his final acts before seeking psychiatric help, he tried to persuade one of his landladies to marry him. When she refused, he asked her sister. And after that, he asked his own sister, Lisa, to allow him to live with her in her small apartment. But years as an urban nomad had left him an irritable, jumpy, and depressed companion who often comported himself in socially inappropriate ways, and his sister didn't feel capable of looking after him. The asylum, then, became Walser's solution to his crippling loneliness, and he appeared satisfied as long as he remained there on his own terms, even continuing to publish. But in 1933, he was transferred against his will, and for reasons largely bureaucratic, to the cantonal asylum in Herisau, in the Appenzell region of eastern Switzerland, an area unfamiliar to him. The transfer upended the life he'd become accustomed to at Waldau. Only the threat of force secured his cooperation the day of his transfer, and he was never published again. In Herisau, Walser assembled paper bags and wiped down dining hall tables after meals. He followed the regimented life of a patient, except that he was one of the few clinic residents allowed to take walks on the surrounding hills on his own recognizance, a privilege he took full advantage of. Some of these walks were undertaken in the company of Karl Selig, his legal guardian and eventual literary executor. Selig visited Walser dozens of times in Herisau, joining him for long rambles through the countryside and then transcribing conversations he later published. These, along with the entries in Walser's medical record, comprise the main surviving documentation of the last years of Walser's life. The now famous microscripts were discovered after Walser's death in 1956, when these hundreds of tiny slips of paper covered in a pencil script just 1 to 2 millimeters high came to light. They were assumed to be written in secret code. The microscripts are astonishing objects, written on various sorts of scrap paper, including business cards, payslips, and rejection letters. They display an incredible textual density, with the tiny pencil marks completely engulfing any original text. The manuscript, catalogued as Microscript 200, for example, which became the story Swine, measures only 2 3/8 by 3 3/16 inches and contains nearly 600 words, about 2 pages of printed prose. Myriad questions surround these tiny documents, which, in conjunction with Walser's diagnosis, have given rise to a mystique. The mad author compelled to minimize his writing within the confines of the asylum. In fact, Walser began drafting his work in microscript form years before entering the clinic. As it became more difficult for him to publish his work in the mid to late 1920s, he created commensurately fewer fair copies for submission. His final novel, The Robber, was composed in microscript form, but never transcribed by its author. As he approached the end of his career, Walser wrote for the pleasure of writing itself. He wrote out of the sense of professional identity he had developed over the decades, out of habit, and out of a desire to continue experimenting. This book bears witness to an extreme artistic delight. In the private realm of Walser's pencil landscape, he can be infinitely witty, irreverent, and cruelly insulting with impunity, writing sentences that swoop and gamble about their subjects, sketching out narrative spaces with aplomb. But he lacked an audience. What he needed wasn't newspaper readers. It was a proper rediscovery by the literary intellectuals who had championed him during his early years. He nearly attracted their attention once more in 1925, when he published his final book, The Rose, with the help of writer-editor Franz Hessel, who at the time was co-translating the first volume of Proust's In Search of Lost Time with his friend Walter Benjamin. Then a virtual unknown, Benjamin wrote an essay about Walser in 1929 that he read on the radio, but Walser's career was as good as over by then. The Rose found few readers, and he was unable to publish another book thereafter. His disappearance into the asylum was a quiet exit that left no ripples in the literary community. Writing Robert Walser's biography was the last thing on my mind when I started translating him more than 30 years ago. I quickly fell in love with his writing, the way each of his sentences takes you on a journey that so often lands you somewhere utterly unexpected. I loved his gentle wit, his sly humor, his endlessly self-effacing grandiloquence, his metaphors that shift our understanding of how the world is made. Translating him helped me understand how he pulled off his narrative sleight of hand again and again. All these years later, he still astonishes me. In the fall of 1987, having just completed a bachelor's degree in German and creative writing, I traveled to Zurich on a Swiss university's grant to spend a year studying and translating at the Robert Walser Archive, then located at the rear garret of a grandly turreted building called the Red Castle on the Zurich waterfront. I enrolled at Universität Zürich and audited some classes there, a lecture on contemporary Swiss literature with Hans Wüssling, Introduction to Translation Studies with Mary Snell Hornby, and a profoundly immersive seminar on James Joyce with Fritz Senn. But mostly I spent my days studying and reading in the room at the Walser Archive set aside for visiting scholars. Most weeks that was just me, with its big wooden table stained a deep forest green, nearly the same hue as the 12 linen-covered volumes of the complete edition that was my prized possession. I slowly filled volume after volume with penciled annotations, ideas about English wording, and notes on which stories would work best in translation. Each morning, as early as I could manage, I would set out from my tiny room in the personnel dormitory of the Swiss Epilepsy Clinic near the Tiefenbrunnen tram depot and walk along the shore of Lake Zurich to the archive, passing swans, boats, the chestnut-lined promenade, the Le Corbusier pavilion, and the grinding gears of sculptor Jean Tanguy's strange, huge Eureka. The Alps appeared at the far end of the long, narrow lake on clear mornings, looking much too large to hide behind clouds, as they did most of the time. It moved me to walk where I knew Walser once had. I hiked through the woods to visit the lake called Greifensee, described in his first published prose text, and took the train to see the house in Badensville where his novel The Assistant was set. But I always returned to the work table at the archive and my dictionaries. I usually stayed until closing time, popping out only at noon to buy a cheese sandwich or slice of vie, a sort of Swiss tart, at a nearby bakery. When the cleaner quit, I jumped at the chance to earn some badly needed cash. The job came with a key to the archive's public areas, and from then on, I would translate as well as mop on weekends. In the next room, seated at a pair of desks shoved back to back, Bernhard Echte and Werner Morlang hunched over thread counters, small magnifying lenses mounted on frames, peering at the tiniest manuscripts I'd ever seen. Using identical typewriters, they turned out draft after draft of their transcriptions for volume 4 of the 6-volume edition in progress, Aus dem Bleistiftgebiet, from the pencil territory. They passed the drafts back and forth until they were satisfied that they'd deciphered each microscript as accurately as possible. Occasionally, one of them would slip me a photocopy of a story they were especially pleased with, and a couple of these found their way into the manuscript I was gradually assembling. Over the course of translating 7 books by Robert Walser, I grew accustomed to ventriloquizing him in the English language voice I hear in my head when I read him in German. Writing his biography, I found it important to keep in mind how much of what I feel I know about him is projection, particularly as he keeps explicitly reminding me, and indeed all his readers, that, as one of his characters declares, no one is entitled to act toward me as if he knew me. But isn't that true of everyone? Psychiatrist and author K. Redfield Jameson writes, "When I teach psychiatry residents and graduate students about psychotherapy, I stress the respect one must keep for the abyss between what one thinks one knows and what one actually knows about another individual's mental life. And of course, this principle holds doubly true when the individual in question lived and died many decades in the past." Walser's radical declaration of unknowability notwithstanding, he often writes stories that are at least in part autobiographical. Occasionally, he goes so far as to explicitly invite readers to view his stories as biographical truth, as in a sort of story, whose narrator opines, "The novel I am constantly writing is always the same one, and it might be described as a variously sliced up or torn apart book of myself." But do those familiar with Walser's writings really know much at all about the life of their author? From early in his career, Walser regularly mixed autobiographical and fictional elements in his work. His first novel, The Tanners, portrays the relationships between four siblings in early adulthood. The characters are transparently based on Walser's own siblings, and the structure of their conflict is cribbed from real life as well. But none of the four is an exact portrait, and not all the events described in the novel correspond to real-life occurrences. Even so, the generally autobiographical thrust of this and many other works tempts us to assign them a documentary function. His first biographer, Robert Machla, leans heavily, too heavily, it seems to me, on Walser's stories and novels in Das Leben Robert Walsers, eine dokumentarische Biografie, The Life of Robert Walser, a Documentary Biography, from 1966. While this book is a path-breaking work of early Walser reception, one I greedily devoured as a young enthusiast, Machla inevitably conflates writer and work, presenting a portrait of his subject distorted through the lens of Walser's own fiction. A similar tactic is employed in Catherine Sauvon's thematically structured biography, Robert Walser, first published in French in 1989. As Walser's first 21st century biographer, I too am often faced with the choice of either quoting from Walser's own writing to bolster a claim or citing nothing at all. Documentary material becomes lamentably sparse during certain periods of his life, as this urban nomad discarded most of the paper that came his way. And so I quote extensively from Walser's work in the present volume, but always keeping in mind that masquerade and dissimulation are crucial themes in his fictional universe. In a letter to the editors of the newspaper Frankfurter Zeitung in 1927, Walser explains that as an essayist, he took inspiration from real-life occurrences, giving them poetic form as seemed to him artistically effective. Glimpsing an advertisement for a performance of Georg Buchner's play Leonce and Lena, for example, prompted him to write the prose piece The Dramatist, claiming, among other things, that he attended the performance in question, which he did not. "I love and honor facts," another of his narrators proclaims, perhaps while winking. A great deal has changed in Walser scholarship since Machla's biography, which commemorated the 10th anniversary of Walser's death and appeared the year of my birth. In the intervening decades, many new works by Walser have been discovered, approximately one-third of his extant oeuvre, along with numerous letters collected recently in a 3-volume edition. And many scholars have gathered invaluable documentary material on his life and work, foremost among them Bernhard Echte, who in 2008 published the 500-page Robert Walser, Sein Leben in Bildern und Texten, Robert Walser, His Life in Images and Texts, an important source text for my book. Above all, though, I rely on the materials I have been collecting since my first visit to the archives in 1987. This rich trove includes articles, book reviews, letters, memoirs, and diary entries by Walser contemporaries whose lives intersected his. I delved into doctor's entries in his medical files, city registry ledgers indicating changes of residence, pay stubs, bank statements, tax forms, and recorded gossip. Most importantly, there is the literature he left us. 4 surviving novels, poetry, dramatic sketches, and thousands of pages of short prose. The stories I tell about Walser's life are interspersed throughout this book with discussions of his most important works and the place they stake out for him in the literary canon. My goal in writing this biography is to show a cannier and sharper-edged side of Walser as an ambitious literary artist who wielded irony as if it were made of iron. He used the pose of naivete to unmask human secrets in all their difficulty and sadness, and had a singular understanding of how to approach, through indirection, insights that resist being grasped outright. Much like this glorious shapeshifter of a writer himself. 1. Behind the Toy Shop, 1878 through 1894. Robert Otto Walser was born at 3 in the afternoon on April 15th, 1878, in a back room above a general store that specialized in toys, but also sold all sorts of sewing and stationery items, leather goods, music and umbrella stands, costume jewelry, and mirrors. The shop was located in a modest-sized city in the Swiss canton of Bern that was called either Biel or Bien, depending on whether one was speaking German or French. The town was just settling into a bilingual identity, with a rapidly growing Francophone population arriving from across the Jura Mountains to the north. Along the lakefront, broad streets and generous vistas greeted travelers arriving at the train station, while the city's dense older core occupied the higher ground at the base of the foothills some distance away, in defense against the flooding that once beset the region. In between lay a newer district, the fashionable heart of town at the time of Walser's birth. As shop owners in this area, his parents, Adolf and Elisa Walser, epitomized the city's growing middle class. The living quarters behind their shop possessed an air of solidity, Robert would write some 50 years later, with characteristic mock formality in a prose piece titled Childhood, and its rooms had bright windows. The early years of Walser's childhood were framed by idyllic settings, according to the narrated memories that appear in virtually identical form in a number of his more overtly autobiographical stories and essays. The narrator of his first published novel, The Tanners, recalls a bright, large nursery which the sun seemed particularly to enjoy filling up with light, in a building where my parents ran a delightful costume jewelry shop where people were always coming in to buy things. And Childhood describes how, as a small child, he enjoyed spinning around and around on the revolving chair at his father's desk on the second floor, from which a narrow flight of stairs led down from the office into the shop or commercial space that was resplendent with luxury articles of all kinds. Since toys were an important part of the family business, the 8 Walser children were never short on playthings. Lena Marie Hauenstein, a childhood friend of Robert's older sister, Lisa, recalls, "We always tried out all the new toys and games at the Walsers first. Other children would get something as a Christmas present, but in that household, there were new things all year round. For instance, once they brought out a magic lantern, and there were always new pictures to put in it, they'd just run down to the shop to get more. Alongside the dolls and jumping jacks, the shop sold the line of educational toys called Fröbel Gifts, designed by the German pedagogue Friedrich Fröbel, who also invented kindergarten. Fröbel's sets of wooden building blocks in various configurations, meant to foster children's inventiveness and free play, suggest the approach to children's upbringing favored in the Walser household. The children were encouraged to run around, and their mother often joined in their games. Robert was the second youngest of the Walser brood. Closest to him in age was Carl, 1 year older. The two were devoted playmates who explored the nearby wooded hills and the courtyard behind the house. This courtyard appears repeatedly in Walser's writings. In Page from a Diary, he recalls returning to his hometown after spending many years in Berlin. How small I felt at the sight of the tiny courtyard where Father used to stack his shipping crates. In the tile-roofed shed, we once played hide-and-seek, and the crates had such an appealing scent. Everything looked just as it had in former times, even the neighbor's little garden where we often caught a glimpse of a pretty girl, and the potter's workshop across the way. Marty Hauenstein describes this courtyard and workshop as well. The two boys were always finding a lump of clay there, and then they would knead it and shape it into buildings, bridges, etc., and they used generous portions of water when working with this clay. Then the unhappy end. Their good mama came and found her two youngest children filthy, hands and feet, faces and hair, Sunday and everyday trousers all covered in clay. I'm sure they were properly scolded, but I never saw those two little dirty birds ever get a whipping. Happy childhoods may have their uses in the lives of writers. Just think of the literary capital Vladimir Nabokov derived from the sun-dappled meadows of his beloved childhood estate. In Robert Walser's case, however, the idyll did not last long. By the time he reached adolescence, a combination of personal and professional setbacks sent his family into a stage of decline that taught him all he needed to know about personal struggles, interpersonal conflicts, and the cruelty with which the world receives those who have fallen in fortune. This isn't to say he wouldn't have become an acute observer of human psychology if his childhood had ended as gloriously as it began. But the traces of early sorrow engraved on his childish heart certainly played a role in determining the sort of writer he would grow up to be. Considerable social and economic disparity informed his parents' respective upbringings. Adolf Walser came from a long line of pastors and intellectuals, and, having been born into a prosperous household of respectable, well-educated burghers, he later displayed a lackadaisical approach to money. It seemed not to worry him inordinately how much he earned and saved, as long as it was enough to keep a roof over his head. His wife, Elisa Walser-Marti, on the other hand, grew up a half-orphan in a hard-scrabble farming community, and her social and financial ambitions far exceeded her husband's. In Portrait of a Father, a piece written 2 years after Adolf Walser's death, Robert offers a fictionalized double portrait of his parents, framed as the remembrances of seven unnamed children gathered at their father's bedside after his passing. The parents described here differ radically from one another in temperament and sensibility. The father is a peace-loving soul who achieved more than many a violent man could accomplish using the so-called will to power, thanks to his strength in being yielding and patient, as well as through the quiet gift of irony. As for the mother, the narrator speculates, it is not immediately obvious, but nonetheless by all means possible, that it may have been our mother who wished to see our father ascend into both commercial and social heights from which, since he proved to be no match for this difficult position, he soon toppled, taking with him, of course, the so respectworthy woman and her ambitions. In an earlier phase of Elisa Marti's life, ambition had been key to her survival. Born in the rural Emmental region, she grew up in precarious circumstances. Her father, Ulrich Marti, had been a respectable craftsman, a nailsmith like many of his line, but at the age of 28, he fell ill with dysentery and died several months before Elisa's birth on March 7, 1839. His widow, Anna Barbara Marti Schurch, was left with three children to support and a little means to do so. Her parents' farm was not thriving, leaving her with few good local options. She packed up her young son and two daughters and moved away. It isn't known to where at first. Eventually, she settled in Biel, to which several of her 11 siblings had also relocated. The announcement of her older daughter Fanny's marriage in 1861 names Biel as the family's place of residence. This daughter made a good match, marrying a wealthy ironmonger, Johann David Rummel. Shortly afterward, young Elisa began to help out in her sister's household. Fanny was often unkind to her little sister, who experienced her as cold and haughty, but there was plenty of work to do in the shop she ran, specializing in silks and trimmings, and she helped her sister begin her own rise from poverty to prosperity. When Elisa married Adolf Walser in 1868, she too came to inhabit a higher social class, all the more so as her new husband came into a significant inheritance just 2 years into their marriage. Elisa was welcomed into the Walser family circle, especially by Adolf's mother, Maria Juliana Walser Hürte, who, like Elisa, had lost her father at a young age. In her new circumstances, Elisa Walser soon blossomed into a lady par excellence, as Claire Zala, a friend of her daughter Lisa, would reminisce many years later. She was the most important figure in the family, the axis around which everything turned. Always gracious and polite, but there was also something resolute about her that commanded respect. In the photographs taken of Elisa in the 1870s, she appears solemn, calm, and kind, posing stiffly in the photographer's studio in elegant dresses buttoned to the neck. Her face is softer in the pictures with her children. In one, a befrocked baby Hermann sits on her hip, while toddler Adolf stands rather formally at her side, at his feet a toy horse that signaled that these two well-dressed children had all a boy could want. Elisa's lips were pressed tightly together in all of the pictures that survive from this period, but looking at her eyes, one can easily imagine her mouth erupting into laughter. It is a mischievous young girl, a banamechi, little Bernese maiden, to quote a dialect expression Robert would use at various points in his writing, an ironic bit of folkloric flair, that Elisa must have smiled and flirted her way into the life of straight-laced young Adolf Walser, the burger in the making. Adolf's background, characterized by generations of prosperity, education, and literary and intellectual achievement, couldn't have been more difficult from that of his wife. The Walsers were a respected clan whose members included pastors, scholars, and merchants. Most of them settled in and around the town of Teufen in the canton of Appenzell-Ausserrhoden in the northeast corner of Switzerland early in the 17th century. These forebearers were often, as Robert Walser would himself become, tremendous walkers, known for the hardiness with which they would dash about the countryside at great speed well into old age. There was one ancestor whose accomplishments Robert particularly took pride in, his great-great-great-grandfather's cousin, Gabriel Walser Zollikofer. Robert would later refer to him in a prose piece titled A Writer as the author of a long historical work, Walser Zollikofer studied theology in Basel, as well as in the German university towns Marburg, Tübingen, Jena, and Halle, before returning to Switzerland to lead congregations in Speicher and Berneck. He enjoyed a reputation as a man of conscience and tolerance, and advocated for the mentally ill. A stalwart walker, he was no doubt well served by his penchant for hiking in his work as a cartographer. Walser Zollikofer drew maps of several Swiss cantons, Luzern, Uri, Glarus, Graubünden, but he specialized in the Appenzell region, to which he devoted an entire volume that appeared in 1740, New Appenzell Chronicle, or Description of the Canton of Appenzell. In later life, he drew 15 new maps of different parts of Switzerland for the 1769 New Atlas of the Swiss Republic. A second notable forebear was Robert's grandfather, Johann Ulrich Walser, a prolific author in his own right. Like many of the Walser line, Johann Ulrich studied theology, but during his studies he became involved in the revolutionary republican politics sweeping Germany and Switzerland in the wake of the Napoleonic Wars. Johann Ulrich got himself thrown out of the University of Tübingen after a rivalry between fraternities representing opposing political views escalated into a battle involving cudgels and axes. Even so, he was ordained as a pastor in 1817 and took up a post in Grub, a small Appenzell town between Heiden and Rorschach. During his studies, Johann Ulrich had begun to write and publish anonymous pamphlets such as The Little Ledger Book in the Land of Utopia, a parody of office life. In addition to satires, he published more serious writing, including a history of the different religions represented in the Appenzell region and a pamphlet promoting the separation of church and state, which he was the first Appenzell pastor to advocate. He wrote a satirical brochure in support of a fanatically anti-Semitic journalist, Hartwig Hundradowski, who appealed to Johann Ulrich as a pro-Republican agitator fighting to strip the German aristocracy of its privilege and power. Johann Ulrich's tongue-in-cheek pamphlet, clear-as-day proof that Hundradowski is the Antichrist described in the Book of Revelations, or the beast from the abyss with seven heads and 10 horns, probably seemed funnier at the time than it does now. The republican form of governance that had briefly been imposed on Switzerland under Napoleon inspired some Swiss liberals of Johann Ulrich's generation to lobby for a modern constitution for Switzerland that would create a strong, centralized government, limiting the power of the individual cantons. Beginning in the 1820s, Johann Ulrich became increasingly involved in the political efforts that would eventually result in the ratification of the new constitution. From his pulpit in Grub, and in numerous newspaper articles and privately printed pamphlets, he defended the position of the republican liberals seeking political change. Although with the separation of church and state, his desiderata included a modernized school system and freedom of religion. His political activities made him a controversial pastor, with some among his congregation grateful for his efforts and others vehemently opposed to them. He nonetheless acquired a reputation for both intelligence and wit in defense of his causes. It was Johann Ulrich who uprooted his branch of the Walser clan from its ancestral home in the Appenzell region in eastern Switzerland. In 1833, he was offered a post at a church in Liestal, a small town outside Basel, halfway across the country, and he accepted it. But the Liestal congregation soon wearied of being confronted with their pastor's political opinions every time they picked up the newspaper, and when Johann Ulrich's initial appointment expired in 1837, they let him go. Stripped of his post, he founded his own publishing house and began printing radical journals and pamphlets written by others, along with Basel Landschaftliches Volksblatt. popular newspaper of the Basel countryside, a newspaper he himself edited. Under his stewardship, the Volksblatt became one of the top circulating papers in Switzerland and an important weapon in the fight to establish a strong federal government. Because Johann Ulrich gave succor to political refugees from the revolution in Germany who had managed to cross the border, he printed their pamphlets too, he was no longer welcome on German soil, or French soil for that matter. Even at home, he was subject to attack by opponents of his cause. One night, someone shot a pair of bullets through his bedroom window, not hitting anyone. In the end, Johann Ulrich was triumphant. A new Swiss constitution based on the American model was ratified in 1848, and he was elected to the new Swiss parliament before his death in 1866. Robert Walser's father, Adolf, was the ninth of Johann Ulrich's 13 children. Of the 13, only one received a university education, the youngest, Friedrich, who became a well-known architect. All the other sons learned trades. Adolf chose the trade of bookbinder and was sent off to apprentice in Paris. This city would later play an important role in his son's fiction, invoked as a distant land of elegance and savoir vivre, a magical place where a cloud might descend to the street and lie there like a resting swan. In Parisian newspapers, the narrator boasts of the sophistication he's acquired thanks to this metropolis. "Since I have been reading the Parisian papers, from which the scent of power emanates, I have become so refined that I do not return greetings, and, what's more, this amazes me not at all." Paris is a place to which Robert Walser has many of his secondary characters travel, painters and poets alike, but never his protagonists. He himself never saw the French capital with his own eyes. Adolf Walser picked Biel to settle in after completing his Parisian apprenticeship in 1864. At the time, this medium-sized Swiss town was just expanding into a city. Biel had been declared part of Canton Bern in the 1815 Vienna Congress and was meant to serve as a buffer between the capital city, Bern, and the Jura region that was incorporated into the canton at the same time. Bern was German-speaking and predominantly Protestant, while the Jura was French-speaking and Catholic. Biel was granted significant municipal powers, including the right to introduce unusually favorable tax laws that led to significant growth, especially in connection with the city's increasing industrialization. The population quickly rose from around 5,600 in 1850 to 11,700, 1870, to 21,200, 1888. During this period, Biel acquired its nickname City of the Future and boasted both a future street and an imagination street. The new tax laws lured a large number of French-speaking watchmakers from the Jura region as the city continued to industrialize. By 1885, two-thirds of Switzerland's watchmakers were employed here. Adolf's business boomed as well. Though he had started out modestly with a workshop producing packing cartons, he was able to relocate a number of times. He did so in 1866, 1867, at least twice in the early 1870s, and twice in 1879, each time choosing a larger, more centrally located storefront. Already in 1867, he took out an advertisement in the Schweizer Handelskurier, Swiss Business Gazette, announcing that he had augmented his shop with a bookbindery and gainerie, a workshop for producing leather goods. The shop itself, according to the advertisement, now carried a generous assortment of writing, postal, packing, and tissue paper, pencils, pens, ink, slates in four sizes from 15 to 30 centimes, rulers, notebooks, notepads, as well as business and household ledgers and bound notebooks in various sizes. Also, sewing cushions, most elegant in form, and a variety of packing materials, including round boxes for pocket watches. In the 1870s, Adolf explained his offerings to include baskets and ladies' handbags in oilcloth and leather, and moved his shop to a grand street with a lot of commercial activity called Schulgasse, present-day Dorfstraße, and from there to Niedergasse, the town's most fashionable address. Over the following several years, he would move from one Niedergasse address to another, including to a particularly fancy, newly renovated building where he started calling his shop Magazin Adolf Walser, to appeal to French-speaking customers, and advertised a much-expanded range of merchandise. One notice describes the shop as a papeterie and quincallerie geschäft, in other words, a stationery and hardware store in which all sorts of household goods could be purchased. Adolf's offerings were well calculated to appeal to the needs and tastes of Biel's rapidly rising middle class. The customer stepping out of the bright sunshine of Niedergasse into the interior of Adolf Walser's shop was greeted by a profusion of objects, everything from tablecloths and petroleum lamps to walking sticks. Display cases of costume jewelry sparkled with necklaces, bracelets, cufflinks, and watch chains. The toy department was renowned for its large selection of dolls, picture books, and games of every description for both children and adults. Adolf himself could often be found behind the counter, chatting with the customers and neighbors who would drop by the shop on their way through town. He was sociable and well-liked. Unlike his own father, who never talked politics, a characteristic borrowed by his son Robert years later for Portrait of Father, that he intervened strikingly little in matters of state, and public concern was definitely not a virtue in him, but in any case it was in keeping with his modest nature. Adolf's business had been well established by the time he married Elisa in 1868, when he was 35 and she was 29. He was certainly in a position to support a wife by then, and his business continued to expand along with his family. The Walser's oldest son, Adolf, was born in 1869, followed by Hermann, 1870, Oskar, 1872, Ernst, 1873, Lisa, 1874, Karl, 1877, Robert, 1878, and Fanny, 1882. At some point along the way, Elisa's mother moved in with them and stayed until her death in 1877. The rapidly growing family relocated as often as the business. The ledger books of Biel's Municipal Registry of Inhabitants show Adolf Walser to have registered at least 8 different private addresses. Robert was born at the height of his family's commercial success, at a point when the Walsers occupied a stately 4-story residence joined at the rear to Adolf's Niedergasse shop. Their home boasted a little second-floor balcony where Elisa could step out for a breath of air while tending to her children. Both buildings belonged to Alexander Schöny, who, like Adolf's father, Johann Ulrich Walser, was a leading figure in the radical Swiss Republican scene, serving in various positions in local government. Like Johann Ulrich, he took in political refugees from across the border in Baden and was so active in their support that his house was nicknamed the Revolutionary Salon, an ironic place of residence for the decidedly unpolitical shopkeeper. By the time the writer Bern in the Revolutionary Salon turned 2, the family had moved a few doors down to a building on Niedergasse, whereas the scion of a petite bourgeois household, Robert spent his early years in relative comfort, his principal occupation getting up to mischief, often together with his brother Karl. Walser wrote no diaries and almost no letters in which he reminisces about his early childhood, but a series of sketches from 1925, the Felix scenes, describe a childhood that seems to accord well with what we know of Walser's early years. The first of these scenes is a soliloquy spoken by the eponymous character, prefaced with the stage direction, Felix in front of his parents' shop. He's 4 or 6 years old. How lovely it is to be so small. You're not responsible for a thing. I'm practically still a riddle to myself in many respects. All the beautiful goods in the shop window. At the very back of the shop, facing the alley, is my father's office. Already I have some inkling of what such an office is for. My sister, who is younger than I am, seems extremely demanding. She has a need which I have already left far behind me. She has to have a stopper in her mouth at all times. Otherwise, she finds the situation deplorable. My mother is always rushing about, as if she can't find the time for many things she would like to devote herself to. She'd come play with me if that were permitted her. It seems to me she has too much to do, and it almost worries me that I have no worries. In other Felix scenes, Walser writes of Felix and his brother lying in wait for a less prosperous companion, the son of a carpenter, whom they plan to capture and humiliate. He outwits them. Of Felix being treated by a doctor after a firecracker burns his face, and of Felix losing an argument to his younger sister. The backdrop for these adventures is the elegant shop, the office, and the courtyard behind it. The scene set here is one of prosperity, with Felix and his brother feeling superior to their working-class playmate, until he informs them that his father will have a word with theirs if they abuse him. Felix's family has a maid. He notes, "I don't think our maid cares too much for me," and a similar observation is recorded in Walser's 1922 prose text, Fidelio, whose narrator reports the family's maid once threatening him with the words, "Just you give some pious thought to that." Many other scoldings receive literary form as well. Young Felix gets drunk on the dregs of an abandoned beer glass at an outer cafe and is spanked for it, and he trespasses to climb a tree to the owner's horror. And the narrator of Fidelio recalls the teacher upbraiding him for some unspecified malfeasance with the words, "Even the Rhine can never wash that away." Was Robert as much of a scamp as all these fictional or semi-fictional characters? Marie Scheitzer-Ehrensberger, another childhood friend of Robert's older sister, Lisa, recalls Robert and Carl as the wild children of an otherwise decorous family. We were always received warmly, but somewhat stiffly at the Walsers. Lisa's father would make her play the piano for us. Meanwhile, Father Walser would fetch a bottle of wine and insist we drink some, even though we didn't like the taste. Sometimes the older brothers would come into the parlor and greet us formally. Meanwhile, we could hear Carl and Robert getting up to mischief and arguing out in the kitchen. Once, as schoolchildren, 4 of us, including Robi, Robert, hiked up Potzingenberg. On the way down, Robi said, "Let's play here." We lined up big rocks like bowling pins. Then he ordered us to knock down the big stones using smaller ones. The bigger ones were the bourgeoisie, he said, and the little ones were socialists. Later we stopped in at a little tavern. Robi ordered wine and rolls for all of us, as a result of which we were soon all giddy. As we were leaving, he said to the innkeeper that we didn't have any money, but that his father was good for it. A major and ongoing source of drama in Robert's early childhood was his turbulent relationship with Carl. The two often quarreled, and Carl spurred on his younger brother to engage in mischief. In several fictional works, Walser writes of feuding brothers who reconcile after the younger brother begs the older one's pardon, even though it was the older brother who was in the wrong. In the version of events presented in his first most autobiographical novel, The Tanners, for example, In a letter written by protagonist Simon to his brother Casper, the quarrel has its roots in a humiliating gesture. Once at the dinner table, he threw a platter of sauerkraut at me because he couldn't resist, saying, "Here, catch." I have to tell you, at the time I was trembling with fury, even if only for the fact that here was this lovely opportunity for you to insult me so cruelly, and there was nothing I could do about it. I caught the platter and was stupid enough to savor the pain of this mortification all up and down my gullet. And do you remember how, one noon, someone came creeping up to you in the kitchen and asked you to be friends with me again? It was an incredible feat of self-control to overcome those feelings of shame and defiance to reach out to you, the very figure of an enemy inclined to scornfully reject me. I did this, and to this day am grateful to myself for doing so. In Felix Scenes, on the other hand, written 19 years later, the affront is omitted. The story presents only the moment of reconciliation. You can hardly be resolved to appreciate sufficiently how much effort this hesitant approach costs me in my proud fraternal soul. By no means does your face express the requisite energy for appreciating me and what I'm up to here by even a finger's length or breadth. And thus shall this kitchen bear witness to one of the boldest, most fearless, and doubtless also the most daredevil feats that a person has ever wrung from himself. The writer who recorded this scene was well into his 40s at the time, and displays a psychological sophistication surely far beyond the capacity of the young children portrayed here. But the structure of the interaction reveals an uncanny prescience, a child apologizing, although he believes himself in the right, for the sake of attaining his brother's approval, which he desires. This is a classic example of the sort of empowerment through active renunciation of power that will appear again and again in Robert Walser's work. As a child, Robert must have found it difficult to assert any personal power at all as the second youngest of 8 siblings, including 5 older brothers. Only Fanny was younger, and even she had some sway over him. Robert would later relate in a letter that as a child he was assigned the task of telling Fanny stories to amuse her, and if he rebelled against this chore, she would complain to their mother, who would punish him. But childish power struggles among siblings would not remain foremost in young Robert's thoughts for long. The family's fortunes changed drastically during the 1880s, with one trauma following another. In October 1884, Robert Walser's oldest brother, Adolf, died after a 3-month-long illness at the age of 15. In a fictionalized memory Robert recorded years later, he recalls playing in the courtyard with Carl as their brother lies ill and having their mother shout at them out the window, calling them monsters. Elsewhere, he writes of having been unable to weep after his brother's death and feeling like a villain as he watched his sister's tears flow. Still inconsolable 2.5 months later, his mother Elisa wrote to her niece, "How often I sat at my child's bedside wringing my hands and imploring the Almighty. God, my God, hear my words in mercy and restore the health of our dear child. Lord, Lord, do not take my child from me. I would have given my own heart's blood to save him." At around the same time, Adolf Walser's business began to collapse. Perhaps he had expanded beyond the point of sustainability. Perhaps the taste of the burgers of Bio had changed and were no longer reflected in his merchandise. Or perhaps he was just one of the many casualties of the depression that rocked the Swiss economy in the early 1880s as the delayed result of railroad speculation in the late 1870s. In any case,
Early in 1885, he was obliged to give up the shop's prestigious Niedergasse location and move to a much smaller space at Zentralstrasse 23. Despite the name of the street, a far more remote neighborhood. Marty Hauenstein recalled years later that after the Walser family's bazaar moved to the Neuquartier district, she would often drop by to visit. For some reason, sales had plummeted, and you got the impression that the good, prosperous circumstances of the highly respected Walser family had taken a turn for the worse. This modest new shop closed sometime in 1886. The last advertisement Adolf published on January 3, 1886, in the Schweizer Handelskurier offered a much more modest list of products than before. Oilcloth tablecloths, imitation tablecloths, rubber sheets for sick beds, everything cheaper than ever and below wholesale prices. The successful merchant had come far down in the world. By 1889, the family resided at Brühlstrasse 69C, in a working-class neighborhood and factory district outside the city center. In a memoiristic essay ostensibly composed by Simon Tanner in The Tanners, he reports, "We were now living at the edge of town in humble lodgings, the sight of which was enough to chill you through." Robert had been 6 years old when his brother died. The Niedergasse shop was lost the month of his 7th birthday. At this young age, he was scarcely able to grasp the gravity of these events, at least not consciously. Worse was to come. The third major blow to strike the Walser family was the decline of Elisa Walser's mental health during this period of personal and financial setbacks. The loss of social status that accompanied her husband's business failures had stressed her psyche to the breaking point, even as he, perhaps displaying the passivity his son later described as being patient and yielding, took these setbacks in stride. Elisa was now re-experiencing the deprivation she had watched her own mother struggle with throughout her childhood. A photograph taken around 1890 shows her dressed as elegantly as before, but her face is hard and sad, with no trace of laughter in her eyes. A letter she wrote to her son Hermann in 1889, studying in Bern thanks to a loan from a mentor, speaks of the hopes she'd had for her children's upbringing and her despair at having been unable to fulfill them. "She always tried," she writes, "to awaken the ideal within all of you, but how often I felt that I had so few intellectual resources at my disposal, and in the chaos of running the shop, there was no chance to develop them. And so, in my helplessness, I begged that my children be given the gifts of intellect they would need, even though I myself was unable to help them in this regard." In this and two other surviving letters to her son, she speaks of the strength she derived from her religious beliefs, exhorting him to keep his own faith alive and speaking of her gratitude for the blessings she had received. "So many riches have come to us from above. We can only have received this opulent blessing from higher spheres." These letters are among the few surviving documents that tell us firsthand what kind of person Robert's mother was and how she struggled. She would write to Hermann of feeling ever less strength in her hands and legs, and of her knees buckling beneath her as she walked one day, making her afraid to leave the house. Besides these words, what we know of her comes from the portrait Walser sketched of her with remarkable consistency in some dozen texts written over 20 years. As he writes in The Merchant, "The lack of success had destroyed the family's domestic existence. The poor woman, proud and sensitive by nature, was made ill by it all." The details of her malady are always delicately circumscribed in these portraits, never shown in sharp focus, but these ailments are invariably psychological. Portrait of Father alludes only glancingly to Adolf's commercial failings. The extent to which our father may have been, shall we say, maladroit in managing his business affairs and their development, is not at all clear to us. Relatives in a position to offer financial help chose not to. The narrator notes how ungenerous it is of the children to harbor the thought that their father, who himself had enjoyed a substantial inheritance, was leaving nothing to them. But no one was more disappointed in him than Elisa. Her general unhappiness over the collapse of the middle-class life she had worked so hard to establish and her dissatisfaction with her husband's lack of ambition and commercial prowess turned her into a nag who could not bring herself to stop reproaching her husband for his failings. Since he was forced to listen to her endless complaints, Robert has his narrator report in Portrait of Father, it cannot be said that our father led a pleasurable life at her side. The children, this piece goes on to note, were swayed by their mother's influence to underestimate their quiet, unassuming father. In retrospect, a wrong the narrator wishes to right by establishing once and for all that the source of their mother's unhappiness was not their father's actions per se, but outside misfortunes that she was less well-equipped to bear than he was. She railed from the depths of her nobly sensitive soul, a glorious rebel, against the weight crashing down upon her and the chastisement she had by no means deserved. For what it's worth, Walser's portraits of his mother tend to downplay the psychological toll that raising so many children and losing one to illness must have had on her, though of course having so large a family was more common then than it is now. When the last of Adolf's shops closed, he began to trade in wine and olive oil, a business that kept the family marginally afloat. Tax records from the late 1880s show that the authorities estimated his income as a wine seller at 500 francs a year, only one-third his earnings a decade before. A copy of a letter of recommendation he received from the municipal council in 1889 shows that he was seeking other employment during this period. But by the early 1890s, his new business began to bring in a bit more money after all, and the family moved again, twice, each time to a somewhat better address, Zentralstrasse 40, Zentralstrasse 52, though they partially financed these moves by taking in lodgers. And despite the financial hardship, certain key features of middle-class life were retained. Adolf sent his son Ernst off to study in Bern, and all the children took music lessons. Robert was assigned the piano, for which, according to his younger sister, Fanny, he lacked both desire and talent, though he would later write with great warmth about his love of music. But while Elisa's children and husband adapted to their new circumstances and went about their lives reasonably contented, something in Elisa had snapped, and she never recovered. Her nerves were constantly frayed, and her children tiptoed around her, carefully avoiding all disturbances that might send her flying into a rage. Walser's second novel, The Assistant, contains a scene inspired by this period in which several children take their mother on an outing to the woods and are overcome with relief when they find a secluded spot that pleases her. The children were all happy that their mother was pleased with their hollow, that she was able to sit there quietly, caressed by all the advantages of so lovely a resting place. They knew the desires and needs of their mother's spirit. From time to time, the children glanced over at their mother to see whether or not she was cross, but no, she was gazing straight in front of her with a kindly and otherwise reticent expression. When their mother was able to smile, which was such a rare occurrence, then the entire surrounding world smiled at them as well. Mother was already ill in those days. She suffered from an excess of sensitivity. How sweet, the children found, the peaceful repose of this woman, who was being gnawed at by unhappiness from all sides. Other portraits, Walser's sketches of his mother, are less placid. The mother in Felix scenes gets so worked up at dinner one night that she hurls a knife at the wall, despite the presence of a respected guest. A moment later, she vehemently objects to having her state of mind analyzed. Arnold. My mother's behavior can be attributed to unsound nerves. Mother. To what can I be attributed, insolent boy? Arnold. Please forgive us, Professor. Mother. Heartless son. Finally, Elisa Walser's profound unhappiness gave way to a long, difficult illness, severe enough to incapacitate her. A letter Walser wrote to his sister Lisa on May 5, 1898, recalls that among all the siblings, it was Lisa who spent the most time tending to their mother during the period when she was suffering. Nowhere in Walser's writings or extant letters is her final affliction named, but an entry in his medical record, decades later, indicates she was apoplectic, that is, had suffered, or was thought at immediate risk of, a stroke. She died on October 22, 1894, when Robert was 16 years old. By then, he'd left school and was well into an apprenticeship as a bank clerk. Despite his young years, his childhood was over. 2. From the bank to the stage. 1885 through 1896. Robert Walser's early departure from school notwithstanding, the primary or secondary school pupil is one of the most frequently encountered figures in his work. His first book-length publication, Fritz Kocha's Essays, Fritz Kocha's Aufsatz, which appeared in 1904 when its author was 26, features a collection of 20 short prose pieces masquerading as the homework assignments of a boy who died shortly after leaving school. The arch, suppressed smile cautiousness with which this narrator addresses Christmas, friendship, music, the fatherland, and school itself points the way to a persona, the precociously insightful child, that will appear again and again in Walser's books. Robert himself was a good and diligent pupil, although stories abound in his later work of being reprimanded as a child both at home and at school. Certainly, he and Carl enjoyed pulling pranks and inventing games, and Carl, in many ways Robert's role model, did not do well at school. Carl's grades were weak, and both his parents and his teachers considered him lazy, at least until he entered Progymnasium, roughly equivalent to junior high school in the United States, and started taking art classes with Jakob Hauselmann, an engraver, photographer, and landscape painter who inspired him to pursue a career as an artist. Robert studied with Hauselmann as well. School also served as a refuge for this seventh of eight children, whose mother didn't have much time for him even before her devastating final illness. Walser has novel protagonist Simon Tanner describe his envy of other children who were lovingly cared for. I had a need to be treated with affection, but this never happened. I had a reputation for being a scallywag, not without cause, as I recall, but it was nonetheless sometimes hurtful always to be reminded of that. I would so have loved to be coddled. School provided a compensation for the minor affronts suffered at home for a pupil who took great satisfaction in bringing home good grades. The narrator of Walser's The Poet reports, "History lessons excite me. Studying Jesus Christ in religion class was a sweet pleasure. I approached the subject not with reluctant diligence, but almost with enjoyment, finding it entertaining." And the narrator of The Young Poet remarks, "Since he wrote a clean, tidy, nimble hand, and apparently took particular pleasure in tracing out his letters, the writing teacher once told him he should aspire to become an office worker."
Robert's school record, covering the years 1885 to 1892, includes row after row of perfect grades. There is only a single year, 1889, when his grades in all categories except drawing sank a little, and a particularly high number of absences, 20, was recorded. This is the year the Walser family moved from their prosperous neighborhood to working-class quarters. One of Robert's teachers, Pastor Harald Matala, had a particularly powerful impact on him. News of Matala's death in 1925 prompted Walser to write about him in several different works. The aforementioned pastor, one narrator reports, was something like a friend to me, who made a friendly impression already simply by now and then running into me in the crowd out in the open air. In other words, I liked him. In Felix Scenes, Walser speaks of a religion teacher interrupting his lesson one day to tell his class how concerned he is about the possibility of war with Germany. Robert may have worried about not living up to this teacher's expectations. In his novel, The Robber, an interlocutor claims that the title character's performance in religion class was disappointing. But in The Tanners, Simon recalls, in religion class, I once delighted one of my teachers by finding just the right word for a certain feeling. Except for Matala, there is no mention anywhere in Walser's work of any teacher or similar mentor who might have encouraged the young pupil to read great works of literature, much less try writing some of his own. Nor does he ever speak of books being read or discussed by his parents, though the family did subscribe to two popular journals, Vom Fels zum Meer, From the Cliffs to the Sea, and Die Gartenlaube, The Arbor. When Walser writes about his childhood enthusiasm for reading, it is usually in connection with the often sensational stories he read in the pages of these magazines. In one piece, for example, he enumerates two pages worth of hideous forms of torture, each presented in disturbingly voyeuristic detail, before dryly remarking, "As a boy in my childhood home, I enjoyed reading, and therefore did quite a lot of it." Some of the cruel acts young Robert read about apparently included sawing people in half, a lot of work for the two strong, sturdy men doing the sawing, and being slowly roasted or braised in a frying pan like a fish or a piece of juicy meat, and thereby being rendered suitable for admission into heaven, as it were, with the most delicate precision. Perhaps literary inspiration arrived in Robert's life by way of his older siblings, Lisa and Ernst, 4 and 5 years Robert Sr., respectively, were bookish. Lisa organized a reading group with several of her friends, led by a young teacher, and Ernst, having decided to go into teaching himself, was attending a gymnasium, high school for pupils with academic aspirations, at the same time Robert was scallywagging his way through grade school. When Ernst left town to enroll in the teacher's seminar at the University of Bern, he bequeathed his standing desk to Robert. In The Tanners, Simon recalls his older brother teaching him to have a sense for the beautiful and noble. From his eyes, we imbibed the fire that filled them when he spoke to us of art. Other sorts of imbibing played a role in Robert's childhood exploits as well, even beyond the incident related by Schätzle Ehrensberger when he ordered wine for his companions and himself. In several of Walser's later stories describing schoolboy misadventures, groups of children, invariably including the protagonist, are caught and punished for consuming beer. The narrator of Knocking reports, "An instructor once took several pupils over his knee and spanked them thoroughly to impress upon them that bars exist only for adults. I also was among the group for beneficially beaten." A similar tale is recounted in the story In Junior High, and indeed the records of the Pohl Gymnasium Robert attended cite an investigation conducted when he was 11
that found 23 pupils to be regular visitors at a pub, apparently not particular about the ages of its patrons, though Robert may not have numbered among the youthful delinquents caught in that particular sting. Another Walser story, The Weibel Boys, tells of a pair of brothers, aged 10 and 11, who get punished for helping themselves to their father's supply of wine. When Robert left school at age 14, he was 1 year shy of completing his Polgymnasium studies. A pupil of his abilities might have been expected to continue on to gymnasium, but instead, Robert began an apprenticeship. Given the family's straitened circumstances and the fact that the state of Elisa's health made her incapable of giving the adolescent boy the supervision and guidance he needed, Adolf wanted Robert to become financially self-sufficient as soon as possible. He took advantage of a personal connection to the director of the Biel branch of the Bern Cantonal Bank, located at Niedergasse 27, to secure an apprenticeship for his youngest son. The young apprentice performed well. Even before the official completion of his training 3 years later, he was issued a certificate on January 3, 1895, confirming that Mr. Walser had been trained in various office tasks, that he writes a beautiful hand, and that with regard to his conduct and industriousness, we can declare ourselves thoroughly satisfied. To be sure, Simon Tanner reports a quite different apprenticeship experience. During the first year, I acquitted myself splendidly, for the novelty of what I encountered in this world filled me with timidity and fear. The second year found me a model apprentice, but in the third year of my apprenticeship, the director cursed me to the devil, keeping me on only as an act of mercy, in deference to my father, whose close acquaintance he'd been for many years. I'd lost all gusto for work of any sort, and spoke insolently to my superiors, whom I considered unworthy to order me around. The protagonist of The Tanners clearly displays a penchant for insubordination, which reveals itself already in the novel's opening scene, in which he quits a job in a bookstore not long after coaxing the proprietor to take him on. Many of Walser's other fictional personas display similar proclivities, taking on work beneath their abilities and then surreptitiously mocking their employers. Writing such characters and exploring their misadventures may well have been vicarious rebellion on Walser's part, perhaps a wish to be more like his bolder, more audacious older brother. There is no record of Robert ever having been anything but a model employee. In one late prose piece, in fact, the narrator confesses, "During my apprenticeship, I behaved stiffly, in a tight-lipped manner, as it were, as though a never-before-seen astonishment at myself and the world was holding its hand before my lips, obviating all possibility of my expressing myself suitably." And Felix Scenes contains a dialogue between Felix and his father, in which the father reports that the boy's boss at the bank has been complaining of his taciturnity, though he was otherwise satisfied with him. Around the same time as Robert started his apprenticeship, he saw his first play. Seats in the third balcony of the Biel Municipal Theater were modestly priced at half a franc. During the winter season, the theater would host various visiting productions, including, on February 18th, 1894, Friedrich Schiller's classic play The Robbers, starring Karl Broich and directed by Peter Hein. This play, and especially its tragic hero, had a profound effect on young Robert and provided a key motif that occupied him throughout his literary career. The Robbers tells the story of two rival aristocratic brothers. Karl Moore is handsome, idealistic, and kind, while his younger brother, Franz, is an unattractive schemer. As the elder son, Karl is in line to become his father's sole heir, but while he is off at university, Franz succeeds in persuading their father to disown him. Carl, shocked at the betrayal, joins...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.